Good evening to all of you. So yesterday I spoke about climate change challenges and thermal power plants. So I gave a lot of introduction about climate change, why, how, CO2 emissions and all. But I didn't give you any solution, direct solution. I told you, that we have enough knowledge and energy so that we can produce high efficient systems so that we can reduce CO2 emissions. That's what I described. But today I'm going to talk about a technology which facilitates an easy CO2 sequestration. In this regard, so I'm going to talk this session. My talk goes in this direction. Some introduction about CO2 emissions and energy in the world, and after that CO2 abatement options and post-combustion CO2 capture and oxy-fuel combustion and CO2 storage options. In this there are many. I'm going to describe to you all the systems that are possible once the CO2 being captured. So this and all we have seen it, right? So by 2035, we're going to see the rising energy used by, I need some response. The next 30 years we're going to use more coal because we have limited resources, and oil. So what I'm trying to say from all this is, we have no other option other than coal or fossil fuels to go ahead with. That's what I wanted to say with those slides. But I spoke a lot yesterday, so that's why I skipped that. Now we go for a... we are saying, okay, we don't use... say we don't use coal. So then what are the other options that we have? We don't use coal because CO2 is emitting very high. Okay, that's definitely one option that I'm going to talk about a little bit. Nuclear. Renewables like? Solar. Geothermal.
Biomass.
Do you all know what is meant by that? That geothermal is? Right, very right. And what about tidal power? Okay, that's very good response. Thank you very much. The great response. So we have these options like solar, wind, biofuels, hydropower, geothermal, tidal, and nuclear power. But have you come across any plant which is big enough at magnitude of 500 megawatt or 800 megawatt with these renewable fuels?
No, sir.
Why?
Initial cost is high, sir. Nuclear power available, sir.
Yeah, why? What are the problems? Why we are not going for it?
Production cost is high.
For nuclear power? Nuclear power is same as thermal power plants.
Yes,
but the most troubling issue is handling and the safety. What happened in Fukushima in Japan, if you could see that, then we all know. Based on that, the German has, these people have planned for by 2020, there shouldn't be any nuclear plant. That is the extreme of the European thinking, that we shouldn't use nuclear power at all. We are going to face a serious consequences if it is going to emit into the atmosphere. So that goes in and we can't talk about it. It's an immediate effect and it's going to last for hundreds and hundreds of years because of
radiation
and its life in the atmosphere is so high, ranked of order of hundreds, right? For uranium and thorium. So that's the problem, that we have some restrictions. See, so you know that geothermal, let's say if you take that, then we can take the heat from the ground and then use for use the that small energy for produce some steam and produce and retrieve the turbine and you get some power. And similarly, tidal power, again you use tidal wave energy and rotate the turbine and get power. And similarly for the hydro power and solar plants, it's a solar power plant is said to be a photovoltaic cells that basically made up of silicon, mostly silicon, right? Silicon. And when sun radiation hits onto the surfaces, it creates an electric field. Based on that, they generate some electricity. So to produce like a 550 megawatt, then you need maybe square kilometers, because its efficiency of the solar panels are very low. So that's order of around 15 to 20%. So that's why, although there are many sources, none of these are commercially viable, and some of them which can do the job for us, but they are very they are not safe environmentally. Safety issues are there. So I just want to make a cross comparison between nuclear, coal, natural gas, wind, solar, and hydro. You could see that the construction cost for the nuclear, coal, natural gas, and hydro power almost the same. And even the production also approximately the same for nuclear and coal and hydro. But for natural gas, you could see that there is a large production cost. Why? Because it's costlier. Of course, availability is not there, but you right now you have something, but it's costlier. Of course, that cost depends on the location to location. Also, see, the solar cost, the production power is zero. You don't have to spend any penny for the production, but the cost is, you see, the approximately four times or even higher than coal or nuclear or hydro or wind power. Why we are not going for hydro power? Any construction cost. Difficulties is one. Deforestation, yes, that's right.
Loss in habitat life.
Aquatic life loss? Okay. Yeah. Like this, there are many environmental concerns like sedimentation. The water from the top mountains or maybe higher regions will drag all the soil from there to here, it will sediment for a longer time, and there is no free flow. So there are many fishes which wanted to go across the rivers, so they all have to stop. I mean, we are forcing them to stop their natural life, so the food cycle will be disturbing. That's what the main idea behind. So okay, now we understood that, okay, we can't go ahead with the renewable fuels, at least for now, for the coming at least one decade, because of its lack of maturity on a commercial scale. And we are also saying that we can't use a thermal power plant because it emits a lot of CO2, and so what to do? What is the solution? Are you agree with my point? Because renewable fuels are there, they are not commercially available right now. And we are saying thermal power plants emit a lot of CO2, we shouldn't go for it. So what is the solution?
Utilization
of?
Fuel.
Which fuel?
Make the system hybrid, sir.
Combined
cycle.
Combined cycle of what?
Renewable sources as well as non-renewable sources.
Renewables and?
Non-renewables.
You mean again you have to go for a coal or natural gas, you mean that?
Little usage, sir.
Little usage.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And any other solutions?
Hydrogen.
Pardon me?
Hydrogen.
Where is hydrogen? You mean hydrogen, I'll stop for the power production, the coal or fossil fuel. Okay. So finally, what I want is oxy-fuel combustion. I am expecting something like this. You go for oxy-fuel combustion or post-combustion CO2 capture, so that you don't emit any CO2 into the atmosphere. See, the problem is not with the thermal power plants, only with the emissions. That means the CO2.
Sir.
I capture all the CO2 and store it in somewhere. That's what I'm going to say about all this coming 45 minutes. So is it okay? So I mean, is the solution is something logical, seems to be okay, or?
Not aware of the solution.
Okay. We'll discuss and then finally we'll come back. So that's what I'm going to say. So possible options for CO2 reductions are, remove CO2 from the atmosphere. Right now we have 390 ppm. You all know about ppm, right? Good. So capture CO2 at the source itself. Capture CO2 at the source itself. So where is the source? There are many sources like transportation, industries, electricity, and there are a lot of sources. There are distributed sources. So, but we have certain sources like power plants. They emit a lot of CO2. They are concentric sources where you can get a lot of CO2 from them. Vehicles and all, it's very much distributed. You have to develop a very high technology, and like petrol fueling, you have to take CO2 also regularly. Go to a petrol tank, please vacate my CO2. You have to say that. Maybe that may come in future, but there's no surprise if it comes. But right now, the large sources like power plants and some industrial sources have been seen as a CO2 removal sources, and developing very high efficient combustion technologies so that we emit less CO2. And another process is convert all carbon to hydrogen, or maybe something which is doesn't contain carbon, so that you can burn that fuel very efficiently, like someone pointing out hydrogen. So you can utilize this carbon to produce some other fuel like hydrogen, and you capture that. Means this is called pre-combustion capture. Before you are combusting it, you are capturing CO2 and then firing it. This is the immediate solution for it. And continuously we can go on for the exactly. So nitrogen is avoided, so thermal loss formation can be completely eliminated. Fuel mass we can't avoid. That's anyhow there the core. Volume of the plant, the flue gas reduces so that the plant size can be reduced. That's one of the advantages. And facilitates complete and easy CO2 sequestration and capturing. Energy penalty is lesser than post-combustion CO2 capture. That just now we have seen. We go by post-combustion capture, the energy penalty for oxygen fuel is lesser. It is other than that easy retrofitting. Just now we have seen, don't disturb any other plant cycle. You retrofit with our air system and recirculation system and CO2 storage system. That's sufficient. So the retrofitting is much easier. For any system you can go by. That's the advantage of it. But the challenges, what are the challenges? See, even one ESP doesn't mean just one block of ESP. There are many several blocks will be connected in series so that, or in parallel, so that you will get the end of the requirement of the government regulation. I have two means, some kind of equilibrium between these two. Beyond that, it may not spread. I mean, that's the end of its limits. And this is also from experiments of 1994, 1999, 2001. And now it is the ocean storage, where CO2 will be compressed beyond its critical points as high as 110 bar, just to make sure that it will be liquid forever, liquid CO2, because it's denser than the water, thereby it's sinking, it never comes out. And here you could see the but these locations has to be identified. And consequence of the CO2 injection on the aquatic life is also question mark. We don't know that. So there are a lot of concerns, but they are saying it's safe. They're claiming it's safe. That's why there have been little studies, concentrated studies on particular techniques to see what is its consequence on the aquatic life. Projects are undergoing, going on. And they have mapped entire world to see what is the CO2 storage capacities that we have. So this is highly prospective and somewhat prospective, and not there is no chance at all. You can see that the orange section here, we have a little bit in western India part, maybe Gujarat, Mumbai, Rajasthan. We have some this North America, and maybe some parts in Europe, and maybe in Russia is a huge amount of CO2 storage capacity. It is estimated between 2,000 to 10,000 gigatons. Right now, how much CO2 we are emitting? Between 2,000, we can say for the next 100 years, up to 100 years. In the meantime, we can develop the renewable energy sources. Are you agree?
Yes.
So maybe I'm thinking that is one possibility. But it's a lot of cost is involved, that's the problem with it. So these are again estimates of different results. Next one is a mineral storage of CO2. Magnesium silicate can be react CO2 and forms magnesium carbonate, and that can be stored as a mineral. It doesn't react, it's environmental friendly. And similarly, sodium carbonate. As a sodium bicarbonate. This is a mineral storage. And the terrestrial storage is like, if you, that's why we say that we have to increase our the plants, and we have to cultivate many plants across the countries so that we can, it takes a lot of CO2 by this Calvin cycle, where the CO2 will be converted to glucose for its survival, so that the CO2 emissions can be reduced. And this is finally this biological CO2 capture, where you can produce, you can use CO2 for growing the algae. The algae can be converted to biodiesel, algae based biodiesel, that can be used for power production. So whatever CO2 that comes in, that can be fed to again algae. So it's a continuous cycle. It means you are renewable fuel and you are consuming CO2 as well as producing power. The numbers has to come out properly, but this is one of the methods. It was already implemented in some places in Hawaii. Algae uptake. So algae biodiesel is famous already. They are looking for a renewable fuel also. That's one of the options. And as well as it also uptakes CO2. So I'm giving you a challenge. Greenhouse gas removal challenge. That was being given by Sir Richard Branson during 2007. By looking at all these facts, he also moved by it and said that he put $25 million worth prize money, who can come up with a commercially viable, demonstrable CO2 removal process. Someone comes up and he'll give $25 million for it. It's an independent jury. We can submit our projects. And you can look at their website to get more in detail. You can simply write as a virgin at challenge. You can type that and you'll get this. So I'm representing BHEL. I spoke a lot about CO2 capture, atmospheric combustion, and so on and so on. So what we are doing there. So we are doing a little bit, not on a large scale, but definitely a big scale. Like we are planning for a 400 kilowatt atmospheric demonstration test. To be conducted maybe coming one year, we're going to conduct this test. As a carbon neutral technology, we wanted to use biomass to produce power, to fire along with coal. We're not saying that we replace coal, we're saying that along with coal, you send some biomass also, and then you can produce power. So that it's a, biomass is a renewable fuel. You got the point? So that's why we are going for it. So that these two projects have been the collaboration with the European Union to organization tech step. This is our facility that we plan to fire oxygen combustion in here. I would like to summarize what I have spoken till now. CO2 capture and storage is one of the best options available to reduce the pollutant emissions considering all other options. Oxy fuel combustion is one of the best options for doing this. Also, there are several other methods, but this is one of the best. oxygen fuel combustion technology is easy to retrofit and may be readily implementable because we are not largely changing it. And also you can use the same material as conventional power plants. You don't have to make any consideration for it. Like in supercritical and advanced also supercritical, you have to consider the material because where the water will be heated to very high temperatures, we don't know what happens at the temperature to the material as well as the water chemistry. And also supported by that we have a huge reserve of CO2 in the across the globe. So we don't have to worry where to store. We have options to store. And finally I would like to thank except BHL and also European Union for funding this project. And also giving me this opportunity, but I'm very much thankful to the extent.
Thank you, Sivaji, for the nice and informative questions.
Sir, you can answer. A civil engineer can do in a power plant. Someone asked me during free time that what a civil engineer can do in a power plant.
Typical 100-kilowatt gasifier. We'll have a gasifier. So you can imagine the role of a civil engineer for a gasifier. So they are very much required for processing gas gas from the water log. Civil engineers are very much required.
In all sections, civil engineers are chemical engineers are required, especially in the context of CO2 sequestration and removal techniques, and also to analyze the coal. CO chemical engineers are needed. Mechanical engineers, by default, they are available. I mean, they are needed for all the structures and the stress analysis and all. And electrical engineers also can make a good contribution for turbine and maybe how efficiently we can transport the electricity. We produce a lot of electricity and we lose by transporting it. Are we not?
Yes.
So you have to find a solution for it. That's a huge challenge for the electrical engineering. Electronics will come in picture. But they, like someone in the morning session told, there are only 4 people operating a big plant. That needs a lot of control and automation that can be done by computer science and electronics and communication. No, we can ask some questions.
But carbon absorption.
For carbon absorption, mono is not my
car. Economy. That's the best.
If I recollect properly, if you go for a mono dye, right, you have more absorption to power. To regenerate, I mean, to remove the CO2 from the amine solution, you need more energy.
It is like the 150 degrees Celsius.
No, it goes to like 120, 150, 180. You go higher amines, you have to increase, you have to give more temperature.
That temperature can be recovered in the water. Can it be?
No.
Sir, how to generate? How to regenerate the amine solution, sir?
Regenerate amine solution? Eat it, and the CO2 will be liberated from the amine solution. Sir, you can separate CO2 because it's a gas. You eat it. The liquid can be recycled back.
Is there any other natural absorptions for CO2? Like charcoal?
Water, you can use water, definitely. Water. How much water? You are coming up with very good ideas, but I would like to remember you that the CO2 that we are emitting from for 1 megawatt electricity would be around 1 ton. 500 megawatt.
And sir, we have a stripper like for biomass gas, right? Not a stripper, a scrubber.
Okay, scrubber.
We have absorption of water only, but it will remove only NOx, not CO2. CO2 okay. Is a lesser amount, it will trace us to out. So how to rescue that? How to remove the CO2 in completely 100%?
100%. Have you tried with amine solutions?
Yes, not amine.
Amine has more absorption capacity. You can try with amine. If you use water, then it has a problem.
Okay, sir.
It's
for a membrane process or
absorption is one of the matured and economically available, not big scale, you can go for it. And then small scale, you can try for membranes and adsorption. Yeah, this would
be. Thank you, sir.
Okay, sewage removal plant located in the center. See, you have to supply energy to regenerate CO2. Regenerate the amine. So you have to give the energy. Where from where you give? You put all these things in a boiler.
What temperature? So that window is specified.
Usually what was taking our primary energy? That's where 600, 700 we want it to utilize only after coming from the ESP, electrostatic generator. Where the temperature could be order of 120 to 160, 170 Celsius.
Sir, we are just sending the carbon dioxide into the air crust. Sir, if there is any damage in the passage, whether it may affect the groundwater levels?
Groundwater level?
Yes, sir.
Level?
Groundwater, underground storage.
Okay. If it sails into the water, what happens?
Yes, sir.
But it's not, I mean, now we drill up to 100 meters at max. But that happens at maybe kilometers down, you have to go there. So if it breaks somewhere in between, what happens is because it's already whole, it comes out. If it comes out, nothing happens. Because the CO2, it's already there.
Okay. You said one type of storage is ocean storage. Marine storage, right?
Marine. Okay. Marine storage, okay. Ocean.
I think if it causes any marine pollute or not.
Yeah, that's what I told. The water treatment is going on, but what they were claiming is that it won't affect. But there is no concrete final saying that it may or may not. This is what is going on.